Hey guys, and welcome to Collider movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Natasha Martinez, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news in the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining us this Friday is Dennis Zen.
Hello everyone, and welcome back to another brand new episode of Collider Movie Talk. It is Friday. Not only is it Friday, it is Logan release day.
Hello.
Already seen this movie twice. You can check out our non-spoilers review. Our spoilers review just went up this morning. Me, Perri, and Schnapp talk about the movie. Go check that out. Go see the movie. It's awesome.
Someone else who's also seen it twice, Perri Nemiroff. Hey.
Just so we can confirm this right now, Ellis, I'm right, right?
You're right.
Yep.
Because the hype is real for Logan. I saw Logan, and I saw Beauty and the Beast, and I saw Kong Skull Island.
You did a triple header
today. I did the Holy Trinity of Beast movies, and now my hair is growing out of control.
Hey, and we may as well introduce your awesome shirt while we're at it, Mark.
Yeah. This is thanks to the lady, Danny, got me this shirt, and I didn't like it that much at the time.
Now you love it.
But now you love it.
Now everybody's praising you.
You've been forced to love it.
Starting to grow on me. Much like avocados this year. I've enjoyed avocados more this year, and now I enjoy avocado shirts more this year.
All right, rounding off our panel, John Rocha.
Hello, everyone. How's it going? I saw Logan as well. It's amazing. Believe the hype. Please watch my spoiler, non-spoiler review later on somewhere on a street corner. There you go.
Spoiler.
Right outside an arc light, probably.
All right, let's get to the first topic.
Okay, according to The Wrap, Stranger Things, David Harbour has screen tested for the role of Cable for 20th Century Fox's Deadpool 2. Casting is not yet complete and Harbour doesn't yet have the job. However, Collider.com's own sources confirm that Harbour is just one of the actors, teasing that there might be others in contention. Sources also told Collider that Michael Shannon was previously in the mix as well, but is no longer in the running due to scheduling issues. Deadpool 2 will be helmed by John Wick co-director David Leitch, with the release date still yet to be determined. Dennis, thoughts on David Harbour as Cable in Deadpool 2?
I think he would be a good fit. He's not my number one choice. He actually wasn't an actor I was thinking of. But this kind of goes to show you, like, you know, I've seen this actor before. I think a lot of people have seen him before, maybe not recognize his name, but you've seen him play some Weasley-type characters in Black Mass, in Walk Amongst the Tombstones, amongst many others. It shows you how one role can just change your whole career. Because he does Stranger Things. He plays the more heroic. It's not the lead role, but kind of a, more of a starring role in that. Yeah. He gets a lot of buzz off of that. There's no way he gets a chance, even remotely a sniff at this Cable role without that. I think he fits the physical type of Cable. Cable is my number one comic book character that we haven't seen yet that I'd like to... It is coming, but is going to be translated to the big screen. You know, there's other people. We do the Walking Dead show. Jeffrey Dean Morgan, I think, would make a great Cable. He's been killing it as Negan. There's a bunch of other people. Ray Stevenson. Another guy from Walking Dead, Michael Cudlitz, who played Abraham. Yeah. Those are some actors I would like to see in the mix. They also mentioned, I think Frosty on Collider.com mentioned that Michael Shannon was in talks to do it as well, which is... As an actor, he's phenomenal. I don't know if he was the right fit, but I think he's fallen out now because of scheduling conflict. Rocha, what do you think?
I think this is an interesting choice because, like you said, Dennis, right, he wouldn't have sniffed this without being in Stranger Things. I've enjoyed his work over decades. I mean, David's been working a long, long time, building his credibility, been series regular on a number of shows and recurring on a number of shows. And like you mentioned, his work on Walk and the Tombstones, but also Revolutionary Road and The Equalizer and Quantum of Solace. You know, he's always a very solid actor, does great work. And this is an interesting choice because there were rumors. I've read some rumors that Russell Crowe really wanted this too. Now, that would have been an awesome Cable, right? And, of course, we talked about Kyle Chandler was the issue that possibly the creative differences caused Tim Miller to leave. David Harbour is a nice choice. And if you look at the casting, it makes sense because Ryan, you want Ryan to be the center focus of this franchise, right? So you cannot cast someone necessarily at this point that's going to overshadow Ryan. If you cast Russell, it's going to overshadow Ryan, overshadow the movie. David Harbour is a nice compliment to what Ryan does. He's obviously shown his abilities in TV and film. So it's an interesting choice. He'll have to buff up, I think, to play the Cable we want to see. But I still would have liked to have seen Kyle Chandler, but if you're going to go David Harbour, I can't vote against it, so I like the idea.
Perri, as a huge fan of Stranger Things, what do you think about this potential casting?
I like this. I mean, clearly we're nowhere close to actually locking someone. Mm. There's still other names in the mix, but should it come that he is cast in the role, I'm going to like this, and he deserves it, because the thing with Stranger Things is obviously it put him in a position to be able to reach out to these types of projects, but this is a guy that's been around forever, and he always makes such an impact in everything he's in. And, you know, his role in Suicide Squad made me a little sad, just because that came... that came amidst... when did Suicide Squad? Oh, my God. I'm having a brain fart. August. So that was before Stranger Things, right?
It was after Stranger Things.
After Stranger Things.
Yeah.
Oh, my
God. It's around the same time. It's when I was watching.
It's Friday. There's coffee in here and nothing else, I swear. but anyway, it's just like his role in Suicide Squad. You know, it made me a little sad when you cast an actor of that caliber and you get so little from him. But then again, I think of something like Black Mass, where I didn't really love the film overall. It's a fine movie, but his scene in that is so good, and it's a moment where that moment is, it's good, you know, because Johnny Depp is a great actor too, but the reason that moment in the movie is so terrifying is because of David Harbour's reaction in it. So I think he's going to be great in anything he touches at this point.
Dennis, I don't drink coffee. I don't trust hot brown dirt water. I go with iced tea, and I'm bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and I'll tell you that. Why are we just supposed to believe a report when I clearly saw a picture of Pierce Brosnan as Cable sitting between Ryan Reynolds and Hugh Jackman? That's your evidence right there. I would love to see David Harbour as this. He wasn't the first guy that jumped to my mind. I was thinking somebody like even Mel Gibson, if you wanted to stretch or he might have another DCU affiliation. Same thing with Michael Shannon. I mean, he just came off playing Zod, so that wasn't the scheduling conflict, but it's a little weird to see somebody jump from one franchise to another different comic book franchise that quickly. Ron Perlman's another guy where it'd be interesting to see him or Stephen Lang. So while David Harbour isn't the first guy that jumped to my mind, I like this casting if it indeed turns out that he is the one that wins the role, because I think he can play off Ryan Reynolds very well. I agree with Rocha to a certain extent that it's not having a huge star. I wouldn't worry about being overshadowed, but with David Harbour, you're probably going to get a Stranger Things joke in Deadpool 2. This is what I think about every time I hear any sort of casting news for Deadpool 2, is how can the character have fun with whatever castmate they bring on screen? I think you can have a lot of fun with David Harbour.
Yeah, well, I agree that there is, in terms of casting, you don't want to overshadow him like a Russell Crowe might or a Mel Gibson might. But at the same time, you have to remember, they eventually want to spin this off so Cable has its own, well, once like leading X-Force and then maybe his own spin-off movie. So they want an actor that they know can lead a film by himself.
I think 10 years ago, Kurt Russell would have been a fantastic choice to play Cable.
Kurt Russell's a fantastic choice today.
He's a little too old now.
I think he's a little busy in a different movie now.
Guardians, but he would have been an interesting choice. I like the idea of Stephen Lang. I still like that idea of Stephen Lang.
Stephen Lang would be good.
Yeah. After Don't Breathe, you're like, oh, God, just to have him have a shot at this. Mm-hmm. And you could see him leading a team like he did in Band of the Hand in Michael Mann's movie in the 80s. That's a deep cut. That's a deep old cut, but I'm just saying that would have been nice, too.
All right, what's next?
According to a report from Deadline, Bumblebee, the first spinoff in the Transformers franchise, has signed Kubo and the Two Strings director Travis Knight to helm the movie, marking his first live-action film. The screenplay, which emerged from Transformers director and Paramount's writer's room project, is from Christina Hodson, with Lorenzo Di Bonaventura, Michael Bay, and Steven Spielberg coming in to produce. Bumblebee is slated to open on June 8th, 2018. Rocha, what do you think about Travis Knight helming the Bumblebee spinoff?
Of course we're tossing the Transformers story to Rocha first.
Well, it's Friday. It must be Transformer news. Yeah, I mean, look, this is a great idea. I loved Kubo and the Two Strings. I was surprised how much I enjoyed it because I saw it way later than other people did, and I'd heard some of the backlash against it. But I absolutely...
Backlash.
Yeah, some people were saying the ending was a little... blah, but I absolutely loved it, and I was very moved by the ending. I didn't know this was his first film that he's ever directed. This guy, let alone he's the son of Phil Knight. He's got money. He don't need to do nothing but sit back and enjoy that money.
He's Phil Knight from Nike's kid?
Yeah.
Why are you working?
I know, that's what I'm saying.
He'd be on a hammock somewhere. Getting hammered. That's probably what I'm going to do later today.
On a Nike hammock. On a Nike swoosh hammock. But no, this is great. I love this idea. He's going to jump into live action. I've loved just about everything Leica has done, except for maybe Box Trolls was a little uneven. Ugh. But everything else.
You're crazy.
No, I'm not crazy. Everything else was good. I enjoyed all that kind of everything Leica's done. But this is going to be interesting because you've got a person who did the script. She just did that film Unforgettable with Katherine Heigl. Still trying to revive her career with that stuff, and it was a terrible movie. But the idea is, she's come out of this writer's room, what does that mean? Like, has she got a really powerful script that they really like? Because Bumblebee is one of these characters that crosses generations and one of these characters that escapes criticism from all these movies, right? He always survives. Nobody ever says bashes Bumblebee. Nobody ever has a problem with how Bumblebee is portrayed. They enjoy the character of Bumblebee. So this is a smart spinoff. You know, people have loved this character since the 80s. Now, my concern is what kind of story they're going to tell. Is it going to be a prequel story? Is it going to be a story that continues off Transformers 5 to lead us into Transformers 6, which is scheduled to come out in 2019? Because they're going to make this come out in 2018, right? And June 8th is what it's scheduled for. So, but it's going to go up against the Godzilla sequel too, which will be an interesting situation. But for me, I love this idea. I love that this guy's taking it over because he brought so much heart and emotion and just a great journey in Kubo and the Two Strings. So what are we going to do with Bumblebee? I look forward to see what he can do with it.
Well, it must be Bizarro Friday because you and me like are in sync on Logan. We're in sync on Kubo and the Two Strings. Something weird is going on today. For me, I was surprised. I love Kubo and the Two Strings. Mm-hmm. I thought it deserved the Academy Award for Best Picture, Animated Picture. It didn't. I still like Zootopia, but I thought this was a very special film. Travis Knight did a great job. I think he actually came in studio to promote Kubo and Two Strings.
He did.
Yeah, did you interview him?
Yeah. He's great.
Yeah. So I thought he would either take on either the next Laika project or maybe an indie drama. So I didn't know he was going to make that jump from something like Kubo and the Two Strings to this very big franchise. I mean, it's going to be the first non-Michael Bay directed Transformers movie that he's doing. And so is he going to fall in the footsteps and kind of keep with that same pattern, or is he going to break off and use what he's learned from? Because before he directed Kubo and Two Strings, he was still basically a producer and owner of Laika Studios. So he's been around that. Is he going to take his own style and put that in the Bumblebee movie? I'm not sure. Ellis?
Dennis, I don't even want to talk about this story. I think we should shut it down right now because I don't want Michael Bay to be watching Movie Talk and be reminded that there's a Bumblebee movie coming out. I don't want him to have anything to do with this. I want him to wake up and say, oh, I should be producing this. I should be giving tips. No, Michael, you should. You got enough stuff to focus on with your Transformers movie. Just let Knight go off and make his little Bumblebee movie and let's get it standalone. I want this to feel like it's totally different from the other Transformers movies. Obviously, it's going to be tied to that universe, but man, if we can get a guy who told a story like he told with Kubo and the Two Strings or any other projects he's worked on, he's been able to inject some heart, some humor into a fun adventure story. If we could get that with Bumblebee, he's the right Transformer to do for Travis Knight because he's got that underdog quality to him that I'd like to see that as a feature film. I just don't want this to turn into Ninja Turtles Out of the Shadows, where you had so much potential, but because of certain people producing, kind of overlording over everything, we don't get the movie that we wanted to get. Michael Bay can direct movies well. 13 Hours was fantastic. The Rock is awesome. I just don't like where he takes Transformers from an action perspective, from a storytelling perspective, and especially from a sense of humor perspective. So if we can get Bumblebee away from that a little bit, I'd be really excited to see this.
Perri, you excited for the Bumblebee spinoff directed by Travis Knight?
I'm a little torn on this one right now. Because on the one hand, if you're going to get me excited about a Transformers movie, it's attaching someone like Travis Knight to direct it. I think this is a really cool opportunity for him just from a character perspective. And this is going to be his first live action movie also. And that's not an easy transition to make.
Only his second movie, too.
Yeah, I don't know if, you know, Kubo is an excellent, excellent film. That's a different story, making that kind of move. I have faith in him. The downside to this to me is I hope this does not foreshadow anything to come for Laika, because everyone knows the Laika movies did not do too well at the box office. And yes, he's got that Nike money in his pocket, but how long can you keep that up until you have to say, we need to stop taking risks and telling these really interesting stories and shooting them in these really interesting ways because it doesn't have wide appeal like a Disney or Pixar movie. So I just hope this decision on his part just means nothing for the state of Laika, and Laika will continue to do what they're doing.
Yeah, that's why I thought I was surprised that he went from something like that really unique to something that's a pre-established franchise and a big tentpole franchise.
Which, I mean, maybe it's a good switch for him. Yeah. It is, you know, stretching your legs and, like, trying to do new things creatively, too. I mean, he's in a little bit of a box with animation and what you can capture stop motion-wise, and now he's kind of just exploring another box, trying to take something that already exists and something that people already love and put his own spin on it. So it could mean good things for Bumblebee. I just don't know about Laika movies.
Well, that's what was so... But Kubo was deceptively a large movie. Like it has a very large scope. And so I think that's what he's going to bring, is this idea that he can still keep the sort of an independent feel to the film, but still put it in a larger box. And I think it's certainly possible.
Keep bringing up the term box. He did Box Trolls. Is this just a clever throwback to Box Trolls? They're the ones that needed cheese, right?
Why are you so angry? Yeah.
I ain't getting on board with that.
He's so angry because you dissed the Box Trolls.
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
How you dare
like the Box
you?
Trolls?
Yeah, yeah. Box Trolls is great. What's wrong with
you guys? Crazy?
A little troll.
Am I in Bizarro World?
Wow, okay.
It ain't a Friday movie talk unless we pick on Rocha.
Yes. I don't understand.
Not picking on you, I'm picking on anybody that doesn't like Box Trolls.
Well, I don't.
Okay, avocado boy.
All right, let's move on to buy or sell. What do we got first?
Okay, Avengers Infinity War and the yet-to-be-titled fourth Avengers film are currently shooting back-to-back and is expected to break the record for biggest budget of all time. And now, according to a new report from the recent African-American Film Critics Association luncheon via report from the Atlanta Business Chronicle, the movies may have a combined production budget of $1 billion. Pinewood Studio co-owner Dan Cathy mentioned that a movie is filming at Pinewood Atlanta Studios with a $1 billion production budget, though Cathy wouldn't name the movie. Most outlets are now speculating that it is in fact the Marvel Disney production. Ellis, buy or sell the two Infinity War movies with a combined budget of $1 billion.
$1 billion is a lot of money to put into anything. I don't have any, I've never spent $1 billion. So I don't know what you would buy with $1 billion to make two movies to this scale. I mean, that's four Waterworlds you could make with $1 billion. It's a lot of money to spend. I think that the production budget, Dennis, I can't imagine it being $1 billion. If you factor in everything that you have to do to market the movie with all the press and all that stuff combined, paying for the first-class hotel rooms and flights for all the stars to go on a worldwide press junket tour, I can see that maybe reaching $1 billion. But two movies costing $1 billion, it's going to make its money back if it does, but that's a lot of money to spend on a production budget.
Rocha.
Yeah, this is madness. I mean, as soon as I saw it, I'm like, what are you spending? And they're getting, and they're doing it in Atlanta with the cheap tax breaks. So They're spending even more money than we think they're spending of the billion. They're getting more mileage out of the billion. So hopefully this means insanely state-of-the-art, cutting-edge special effects that we haven't even heard about that they're working on. And, of course, you've got to pay all these actors. And apparently, from what we've got in the notes here, Robert Downey Jr. made $40 million in the last one, and he's going to make $200 million possibly with these two films. Madness. So obviously, there's a lot of money to go around. My concern is when you put this kind of pressure on a film, what does this mean? Especially, there's already enough pressure that you know, are they going to hit all the notes right with Infinity War with all these characters that throw? I mean, they're basically three-timing what they did on Civil War with all these different characters coming in and trying to write stories and subplots for all of them to make it worth them being in the movie. Now you put this pressure on it, they're spending that much money on both of these films. I don't know who let this slip out, too. Was that some convention or something?
Luncheon.
Some luncheon, yeah. Who's going to let this? Why would they let this slip out? I just don't understand.
Perri?
Well, I don't think it was a matter of letting it slip. It also just could have been this person exaggerating. I was not at this luncheon. I have no clue what context this point was brought up in, but $1 billion on two movies is insane. I feel like if we're getting to the point where we're spending that much money to make movies,
let's just read books again.
I'm sure you all bought that.
Yeah.
That is just absolutely crazy to me, though. And, you know, not Waterworlds, but when you think about it, $1 billion and thinking about just how many great unknown filmmakers are out there with like teeny, you know, maybe at maximum $1 million ideas in their back pockets, it's just kind of sad to me. Even though I love the Marvel Cinematic Universe and I really want two great Avengers movies, that's a lot of money. So even if you did break it down and each movie costs $500 million, the one that has the record right now is Pirates of the Caribbean on Stranger Tides, and it holds the record with $378.5 million.
That is
$500 million is stupid. It's and $500 million is a long ways away for that. But I guess if you consider the roster of people they have, because this one report said that most of the big stars of Age of Ultron were paid between $5 to $10 million. So if you think about all those crazy rumors about how many big characters are going to show up in these movies, and you think of that price range, that's where most of this is coming from, I guess.
Gosh. I got to start working out and taking acting class, man. Jesus.
But do you buy or sell that they actually are spending $1 billion? Because this is someone that said this. I actually sell that it's $1 billion. I think it's probably something close to that, and he just kind of rounded up. as far as them spending
them. Where, Dennis?
Like 800 something, like, that's, you know, like 150, and he's just like, ah,
it's
a billion.
Yeah, but look, I mean, I've been to a lot of luncheons, okay? Drinking goes on at luncheons,
yeah.
All right? There's free booze, they never check IDs. You're staying in a hotel, they're having a luncheon, go ahead and wander in, make yourself a plate, have a couple Heinekens and leave. If this thing is $780 million combined, and you're on stage and you're speaking, you might round it up to $1 billion. So that's probably where I give the credibility of the story.
Yeah, and I think a lot of it is what you're talking about, cast. You know, mm-hmm. In Civil War, even as big as that was, we didn't have Guardians of the Galaxy, we didn't have Thor, we didn't have the Hulk, we didn't have Doctor Strange, we didn't have Thanos. There's still a bunch
Captain
of characters,
Marvel,
actors that they weren't paying. So now in this one, and I still like this whole like part one, part two. They've decided to get rid of that part two. It's still part two. Mm. There's a reason why they're filming these two movies together. They just want to get away from what. With Harry Potter and Hunger Games, how they had the part one, part two. I think Twilight did it as well. They just want to get away from that because they seem to be getting less box office sales with that. They're going to call it something else. It's going to be still tied into it. That's why they're shooting it together.
Just to compare, Age of Ultron had a reported production budget of $250 million.
Well, look, the big news out of this story is that John Rocha is going to start going to the gym and taking acting classes again. Because that's an inspirational story. Hey, what made you want to get back into acting? Well, I saw how much money the Avengers guys were making, and I decided to go to Crunch.
$5 to $10 million, absolutely. But I think a lot of this money is probably also going to be, because it's all in space. It's going to be all in space. So you got to create all the worlds, the planets, all the surface, all that stuff that they're going to be on. So that's probably where a majority of the money is going when you take away the casting.
But seeing as the Russos are in charge of this, I'm very confident. You know what they do with Winter Soldier, what they do with Civil War. So I'm feeling like, you know, there's always that concern of juggling all these characters, but I think they can do it.
Does it actually increase y'all's confidence a little bit in the movie and the story we're going to get because its production budget is rumored to be $1 billion?
No.
Like nobody's going to write a check for $1 billion unless they read it. They're like, this is damn good. You know, nobody's going to be like, well, we have an outline. We're going to improvise some stuff. Give me $1 billion. Like, you know what you have. If you're making a movie that costs this much dough, you know what you have.
And you believe in the franchise and the brand. I mean, that's why Lucas funded his own Star Wars movies with the prequels, because he had the money, and it was a sure thing. It was like he could have put anything on there.
Right.
Whether you like or dislike the prequels, he knew whatever he put out there with the Star Wars logo and the music, it was going to make money.
I just want a shot from this luncheon. It's Dr. Evil at the mic. $1 billion.
All right, what's next?
As fans ready themselves for Jordan Boat Roberts' Kong Skull Island, Collider.com has an exclusive look at Paul Ainsworth's tribute poster for the movie as part of a new series of original posters celebrating the mythology of King Kong. The posters will be on display at an upcoming exhibit by Bottleneck Gallery, with the latest you can see on Collider.com as part of the exclusive. This should get you more than ready for Kong Skull Island's March 10th premiere. Perri, buy or sell the new poster for Kong Skull Island.
I would literally buy it. I love this. I love all of the posters that have come out for this. I mean, and it's really cool how every single one of them captures that same color palette, which is also all over all the teasers. And it's just like every single time I drive around and I see these billboards, just those colors and the look of Kong in general, you see that, you're going to stop and actually take notice of that. And you're probably going to want to see the movie. And that tagline, all hail the king, damn right, that's how you make a poster.
I'm going to buy this as well. I like the look of it. It has kind of a throwback comic book style. And you're right. There's like the different posters they've had for this movie are all
so
different styles, which is, you know, unusual. Usually they kind of focus on one style and they'll replicate that throughout the movie posters, but they're going with a different style for each one. So I enjoy this one. Ellis?
Yeah, the marketing campaign for this movie has been fantastic, from the really good trailers to showing us enough of Kong in posters and other marketing material. This movie was originally just called Skull Island. When they first conceptualized it, it was just called Skull Island, and now they clearly know how to sell this movie better because you're putting King Kong front and center. It's called Kong Skull Island. It says all hail the king. Makes a lot of sense. I saw the movie yesterday, and you're gonna get a fair amount of that big boy on screen. So it's awesome. These posters are not lying to you.
Rocha?
Yeah, I love this poster. I think it's fantastic. I was so inspired. I went to Paul Ainsworth, his website, which is paydesign.net, and he's got a bunch of these similar style of posters, The Clockwork Orange, Man of Steel, Age of Ultron, and one of my favorites, The Burbs, Dan Merle. He has a thing for The Burbs. Yeah, a little shout out there. So it's really interesting, the stuff he's able to do with color. He has a Star Wars one. He has a Fargo, Life Aquatic. These are great styles, Office Space, just brilliant, brilliant stuff that he does. So if you want to go see more of his posters, go there. But this is so fantastic because the colors are so vibrant. You get the, I mean, it's fire. It's essentially fire, you know? And so what you're seeing a lot with the trailer is a very orange hue through most of the trailer. So this totally, you know, touches that. And Perri's right. All hail the king. That's just a great, great tagline. And it's real small, subtle, right at the bottom. It just kind of, it kind of follows your eyes. You go down the poster, and it really is a great cherry on top of that cake.
All right. What's the next buy or sell? The one that we're eagerly anticipating.
Okay. Warner Brothers has released a new Red Band trailer for Chips, the TV-to-film comedy remake that stars Dax Shepard and Michael Pena. The two play California Highway Patrol officers John Baker and Frank Ponch Poncherello, respectively, with the two investigating a heist that may have its roots inside their own department. The film also stars Rosa Salazar, Adam Brody, Kristen Bell, and Vincent D'Onofrio. It opens in theaters on March 24th. Dennis, since you're so excited, buy or sell the Red Band trailer for Chips?
Sell, sell, sell. Oh, man, this trailer. Watching this thing was tough. I mean, you're watching, you're not laughing. And the thing is, too, before you hear this movie, it's rated R. So you see the regular trailer and you think, like with 21 Jump Street, maybe because of the rating, they have to hide certain jokes because they're just, you can't show them in a regular trailer. This is the Red Band trailer, so there's nothing that they have to hold back. Still nothing funny. It's like a wannabe 21 Jump Street. I like Michael Pena a lot. Mm-hmm. I like to see him in a leading role here. Just there's nothing for me here. Ellis?
Yeah, I mean, you could try to sell this trailer a billion times and still not make the Avengers production budget back. Mm-hmm. Just not a good trailer. Like, I wanted to like Chips. I like the TV show. It's ridiculous. It's dumb, but it was fun. It was 70s, you know, just like everything great about the 1970s TV shows was epitomized with Chips. All the good, all the bad. You can watch it on reruns. It's fantastic. This movie, it's not even going for that at all. It clearly is just trying to be a 21 or 22 Jump Street knockoff, and it's a bummer because I look at this trailer a lot like the Brothers Grimsby trailer, where they threw so much at you in the trailer, and it felt a little too desperate to sell the movie. Nothing really hit in the trailer for me, and I'm disappointed to say it. I'm not looking forward to Chips.
Rocha.
Yeah, this is one of those shows that I loved growing up as a kid because, of course, you had Eric Estrada, so Latino kid. You're like, oh, yeah, this is awesome. He's a lead guy. And so when they were redoing it and they cast Michael Pena, I was super happy because I'm a big fan of Pena, like you said, Dennis. But this is terrible, man. I didn't laugh once, and I watched it twice to see, like, did I miss a joke? Am I in a bad mood or something? Like, did I not have enough pancakes this morning? Like, I watched it again, and it was just horrible. And it's not funny at all. And he throws his wife in there, which is great. It's always great to see Kristen Bell. I love her to death. But like this, there's nothing funny. And to see that Dax wrote it and directed it, Dax is okay. I just don't think he's that funny. So to know that he wrote it and then he directed it, it just already puts some strikes against it for me. And then the jokes are like, they're just jokes from a frat comedy from the 80s or early 90s. It's just dumb. Like, he put his face into his pubic bone. Like, that's funny, you know? Like, it's all this stuff that's like real simple humor that there's nothing really interesting here. Whereas 21 Jump Street was really funny in how it played with the conventions of its original source material and brought it into the modern, what's going on now. So, and I think this misses every single beat it could possibly hit. And I think Pena is doing a great job in that trailer trying to make all these jokes work, and they just don't.
Yeah, I mean, look, Dennis, I'm wearing an avocado shirt, okay? Mm. Lowbrow humor is not going to fly with me. I need to be more intelligent.
You high-end stuff. Perri, are you first in line for this movie?
Oh, sorry. I'm too busy looking at Paul Ainsworth's art instead of thinking about Chips. Every single time I see a Chips promo, I wish that it was actually a promo for War on Everyone, the one that Michael Pena's in with Alexander Skarsgård. Mm. That is a funny movie. If you want to see Michael Pena in a cop movie, go watch that one, because that is an R-rated amazing ride, and this is just not for me. I have absolutely no interest in Chips.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Okay. This whole idea of eating someone's butt out, like that's the whole point of the jokes, like three or four times.
You just can't help yourself.
It's just so dumb. Yeah. It's just so dumb. I'm sorry.
Sorry, I'm awake. What did you just say?
All right. Sony Pictures has released a new trailer for Danny Boyle's T2 Trainspotting. The sequel to Boyle's 1996 breakout film is based on Irvine Welsh's follow-up novel entitled Porno and reunites Renton, played by Ewan McGregor, with Spud, Sick Boy, and Begbie. And while while they're 20 years older and cleaned up from their heroin addictions, there are plenty of adventures that pop up when the old friends meet up again. T2 Trainspotting arrives in U.S. theaters in limited release on March 17th. Ellis, buy or sell the new trailer for T2 Trainspotting.
I'll buy it, Natasha. I thought it was funny. I thought it was charming. And it did something that I didn't think a Trainspotting 2 trailer would do. It showed me a lot of critics that have already seen the movie talking about how great it is, which is awesome to hear because I haven't heard about a lot of screenings for this movie yet. But apparently people have seen it and they say it holds up with the original, which is high praise. I'm interested to see what happened with these characters in the last 20 years, and the trailer does a good job of showing us that they have matriculated from being the you know, malcontent youth that they used to be, but they still have some of those pulls, some of those ambitions, some of those drives back to the dark side. So I'm very excited to check out Trainspotting 2. It looks like a worthy sequel to the original.
Perri, you buy or sell this trailer?
I think I'll buy it. I'm not the biggest Trainspotting fan, so even though I like the movie, I was never in a position where I was thinking, I want another one now. But the fact that everybody came back to make this movie has had me a little more excited than I would have thought I was. This trailer, I think, does a much better job than the one that we had discussed prior with appealing to fans of the original while also adding a couple touches that might pique people's interest who have no idea what Trainspotting is. I wouldn't really say this is a story trailer that gets you hooked or fills you in from the beginning on, but it's got enough appeal across the board that I think this is going to start catching more eyes than the last one.
Rocha?
Yeah, I loved it. As a massive, massive fan of Trainspotting, the original Trainspotting, I was like a little trepidations about them making a sequel 20 years later. You know, you get those weird vibes about that. Did we need another one? It ended perfectly the way it did. It was a nice self-contained film. But it seems like they've done a nice job of showing them years later. And they touch on what happened in the original movie. Not a lot, though. Just enough to give you ideas that's in there. But then they're also showing them, like, what it's like now in their lives. Because, yeah, I'm not the same guy I was in my 20s. I'm sure Ellis isn't. He's sometimes. But, no, like, you know.
Sadly, I'm the exact same person.
But you grow up. And so when you grow up, what happens to you? And what happens to your relationships? And especially Begbie coming back. Are they going to confront that stuff with Renton and with Sick Boy and Spud and all? Like, what are they going to figure out amongst each other? And how are they going to come together? And is it just a feel-good movie where they're just talking about how to find, like, rediscovering their joy of life by riding on top of Vanagon's or something? I don't know, but there's enough here for me to enjoy as a huge fan of the original. And I think, Ellis, what you said, having all those 4 stars and the critics' reviews from reputable magazines and reputable film reviewers has got me excited because it already came out in Britain in January. Mm-hmm. So that's where you're getting most of those reviews from. Yeah, so there's probably some. people are excited. I can't wait to see this, and I like that everyone came back. That tells me that they have a good script and they have a good reason to come back.
Like, Dennis, it's Friday. I can't have Rocha throwing facts at me here, okay? This is totally, I'm not prepared for this kind of assault.
Well, I still don't like that they call it T2 because there's only one
true,
T2.
True.
I buy this trailer. I like where they go. They go, you know, they throw back to the old movie, the first movie. Yeah. With the trailer, you have Iggy Pop's Lust for Life. They use that again. They use clips from the first one. They use this kind of the same pattern. And so they even parallel some of the shots that were in the first trailer in this one. So I think Danny Boyle is a fantastic director. He's one of my favorite directors working today. So I'm looking forward to this film. All right, what's next?
According to a report from Variety, New Line Cinema is in early development on a horror film set in the iconic world from L. Frank Baum's novel, The Wonderful Wizard of Oz.
No.
New Line, a division of Warner Brothers, has brought the entitled pitch by Blacklist screenwriter Mike Van Ways, who will pen the movie. The project will now go out to producers in order to secure a production budget and possible release date. Perri, buy or sell a horror movie set inside the world of Oz?
You don't have to ask me that question. I buy this. This was the story today that I was waiting for. When this news dropped and I saw that headline, I thought it might have been a joke or so, or I would read the article and it would be something where, you know, it was just like a random idea, something that didn't seem like it could pan out. This is brilliant. Have any of you ever seen Return to Oz?
Oh, yeah.
That is a horrific movie. There is so much potential to set a horror movie within this world. I mean, Wizard of Oz used to scare the crap out of me, yet I used to love... I guess that makes sense. Scare the crap out of me, yet I used to love it as a kid. So I think this is one of the greatest ideas in the genre I've heard in a little while. And this... I don't know too much about this writer that they have on board to do it, except for the fact that... He's got a blacklist script, and it's called Hammer Space, and he sold that to Warner Brothers, and he also has something else that's based at Fox Animation. So clearly, his name, Mike Van Ways, he's got something. And if studios are looking at him and are snatching him up now, I imagine he could be a good person to actually make a great movie out of this concept.
Rooka?
Yeah, absolutely. I buy it like crazy. Like Perri, that's one of the appeals of Wizard of Oz, if you see it at a young enough age, is the horror mixed in with the happiness, mixed in with the deeper meaning, the deeper subject matter that they're tackling in that film. So to me, of course, you have a house that lands on a witch right off the bat. Right, that's the horror right there. And then you have these weird creatures in there. So to me, and the trees is what usually scared me when I was a kid, is those trees reaching out and grabbing and branches, all that kind of stuff, which we saw in Poltergeist too, with that doll reaching around and taking by the neck. Anything where your strangulation brings me horror, basically. So I love that in The Wizard of Oz. So the fact that they're going to do horror with this, it's fantastic, because already it's supposed to have that kind of gothic feel to it in inside the story. So the fact that they're going to exploit this and pursue it even further, and I hope they do a great job with it, because this is a genre that could use a horror film. I mean, this is the franchise that could use a horror film, and it would be great. And there's enough in here with the flying monkeys and everything else. There's enough in there to explore horror aspects in it.
Well, on the subject of strangulation, I have some websites that'll turn your frown upside down. You ask me if I buy a movie that is horror that takes place in the world of Wizard of Oz, I will ask you, are there flying monkeys in the Wizard of Oz? You're damn right there are. This is the biggest buy I've ever done on this show. Can the Avengers carve out some of their money to give me to buy this movie? I am over the moon about this. This is a great idea. There's so much to explore in Oz, and every time we go back to Oz, it doesn't have to be like Oz the Great and Powerful, where, oh, let's make sure that we're not stepping on the toes of the original. This one clearly wants to go in a different direction. I don't need to see Dorothy. I don't need to see Scarecrow. I use a little bit of Toto. I don't even need the witches, to be honest with you. I just want something else to take place in this magical world of Oz. This is an awesome idea. Flying monkeys, bring it on.
I'm going to buy it as well. Actually, when I first heard about this, I thought of the, I don't know if you guys know Todd McFarlane, who's a comic book artist who ended up making toys. He made this line of Wizard of Oz toys that were kind of horror style gothic. Oh, nice. That's when I thought that had something to do with that, but it's not. It's completely separate. Like Perri said, it's Mike Van Ways who wrote or did this pitch. He also has two scripts in development. We don't have a track history, though, of his products, right, or his, because they're still in production. We haven't seen them, but I like this idea a lot.
These are nuts.
What,
these
you're looking
toys?
At the McFarlane?
No.
This guy did Spawn. What do you expect? Yeah.
So, these are great.
This kind of gothic horror style, I think, like, as opposed to like a straight up horror, but something that's more gothic and a little throw. As far as Wizard of Oz is concerned, the witch is what scared me.
Oh, wow.
Like, just the green face paint, right, and just I'm melting.
You know what my favorite part about movie talk is when we're looking at websites.
Yes, during Perri's been on a lot of websites.
I've actually
today.
Been shopping this entire show. I'm going to have a whole bunch of new toys and a whole bunch of posters. Well,
there we go.
I'm having Rocha turn me onto this website called Ashley Madison. It's very, very engaging.
That's ridiculous.
All right, guys, before we get...
I changed my username on that. I apologize.
Before we get on to a mailbag, I remind you that we're going to take your live Twitter questions at the end of the show. You can tweet us at Collider Video. Also, there's a bunch of shows dropping today or that have come out. We have a new awesome tacker that's going to be on go90.com. Check that out. That's with Jeremy Johns. I actually directed a sketch video. It's a La La Land parody.
Nice.
So you can check it on there.
Sure, you did better than Dax.
I don't know, but I hope so. You can check that out. We also have a couple contests going on. For our Los Angeles viewers, we have a Kong Skull Island IMAX screening on Tuesday. Q&A with the director, Jordan Voight Roberts. That screens Tuesday, March 7th at 7 p.m. To see this free screen, you need to email the collidermailbox@gmail.com.
Here goes Rocha.
With the subject line, I want to see Kong Skull Island in IMAX 3D. Hey, you got to go see the Logan.
I did. Yeah. I did. You're right.
And you didn't you didn't have to email.
No. Don't kill my bit, Dennis.
Yeah. There's also Arrival. We have a Mondo, limited Mondo posters.
Those posters are great posters, too. You're going to want to enter to win those.
Yeah, they're designed by artist Kevin Tong. You can go to collider.com. There's a link in the show notes. You can go there and see how you can win that. There's a new Schmodown coming out 2 p.m. today. Big one. Yeah. Clark Wolf versus JT. It's got title implications. Yes, I know Rocha over there is... you know, shaking his boots.
I don't fear anybody, okay. But those are two very powerful contestants, so it'll be fun to watch this match.
Yeah, and we also have mailbags and behind the scenes this weekend. So let's move on to a mailbag. Natasha, what do we got?
Okay, Omar Correa writes, with more big movies coming through Netflix like Will Smith's Bright, Scorsese's The Irishman, and Brad Pitt's War Machine, could this be the beginning of a big change in how we rate and declare which movies are successful? With releases being on Netflix, there's no box office to speak of, and Netflix will never release view counts on these movies. I feel like this is going to change the movie punditry landscape in the next few years. What do you guys think? Would love to hear your thoughts.
I think movie punditry will always be changing, but this would affect more of talking about how a movie is successful or not, because then now you're not talking about box office anymore. And if Netflix is not releasing numbers, they may say, oh, this is doing well. They always talk about in terms of, like, this is, you know, been viewed by the most of our audience than any other movie or series or whatnot. So the focus will kind of lean more towards, is this a good movie or not, which is mostly what movie critics and movie punditry is mostly about, is about whether a film is good or not. We do talk about box office success, but the most important thing is the quality of the movie. Perri?
Yeah, I think you're definitely on the right track there. I don't think punditry is really going to change. We're still going to talk about and review movies, I think, the same way. If anything, our industry just changes with technology and outlets and different platforms we can use, but I just wonder when the day is going to come where outlets like Box Office Mojo, I'm a huge fan of Box Office Mojo, you guys know I'm a nerd with numbers, so I'm there all the time, but I just wonder when the time is going to come where they're going to have to find a way to incorporate Netflix and Amazon movies, because we're talking about them more and more as the months go on, and eventually if we're going to be talking about if a movie is financially successful or not, that those movies are going to have to be represented on outlets like that.
Yeah,
Ellis.
We can go to Rocha. Okay,
no, that's fine.
On this topic, go, please.
I don't know that movie punditry will change. I agree with you, because punditry is about criticizing the movie, quality of the movie. So that won't change. What will change probably is the accessibility of it and the quickness with which you judge a film good or bad. Because on Netflix, people who are in this business and have connections through Netflix have already gotten the first six episodes of Iron Fist. So that kind of stuff, the fact that you'll have access to it quicker, you'll be able to release your points of views, your spoiler, non-spoiler reviews, that'll increase. The speed with which that happens will increase. But I don't think the punditry will change unless you're talking about scope of the film and the budgets of these films, how that's going to affect the quality that comes down the pike and the streaming nature of it. But other than that, I don't see it'll change that much.
The landscape that's really changing here, Dennis, is how many times I invite people over to my place to watch new movies for the very first time, whether I have that cool box for $300 or now I have Netflix. For Netflix movies, I'm only going to charge you $5.
Oh, okay.
And there's obviously the bathroom courtesy fee for $1. It's timed, so 5 minutes or
per
longer.
Minute?
It's $2. Oh, yeah. Okay. As far as the movie punditry goes, I agree with Rocha and Perri. I think that you're always going to be able to criticize movies and have a voice. If you go on Rotten Tomatoes, for example, it still seems like they're being just as fair to those movies and TV shows as they are theatrical releases, because Stranger Things has 95% right now on Rotten Tomatoes. The Ridiculous Six, 0%. Literally 0%. 33 reviews. Yeah, 33 people took the time to review that movie. None of them gave it a good review. Thus, the 0%. You got to think Netflix is going to release numbers eventually, though, right?
They have to.
Right?
Because it's so hard to read between the lines. Like you can do it if Bright gets three sequels greenlit and War Machine doesn't, then we're going to be like, well, is Bright better? Or does War Machine just not have room for a sequel? So it's a little bit too hard to figure out from a business perspective. I'd like to see the numbers released, but I also want to see what the Oscar tallies are, too. So.
Well, you figure shareholders would want to know if they're investing their money, because Netflix is basically kind of like how Amazon was when it first started, where it's like they're investing. Netflix isn't making that much money. It's more like spending all this money so that in the future everyone has Netflix. Eventually they're going to have to start releasing numbers to their shareholders because they want to know, is this successful or not?
Actually, you know how it would change our industry is the way it is now, and I was talking about this when we did our spoiler review of Logan. You go and you see a movie once and you write your review. I've had many instances where my opinion has changed on a second viewing, or I happen to notice little details. So if anything, if we're getting a lot of new movies on Netflix and Amazon where you can start rewinding, we might be getting more thorough spoiler reviews. We might be getting, you might see a shift in opinion in some sense. I mean, I guess viewers will never know how many times someone watched it before they settled on whatever score they're giving it in the actual review, but that could kind
of
change the
There's
game a little.
There's less chance of people annoying you at your home, too. Like, if somebody's really, like, just yapping throughout the movie or making noises during the screening, you don't have to worry about that unless you invite them into your home, at which point you kick them out.
I would like to see to find out a little more. Hopefully, as this becomes bigger and bigger, the people who are interviewing these directors start to ask them what the process is like. Because I have a couple of friends who've tried to negotiate with Netflix for films, and they pay you, depending on your status in the business, they pay you little to nothing at the beginning and then pay you out over 5 years. So what is the situation here? Are they paying them guaranteed money? It's like sports, right? He's guaranteeing contract. You're going to pay me $24 million. Boom. And then if the movie makes money, I'll make a little bit of that, but not that much. So I want to hear how they're pitching this stuff to Martin Scorsese, how they're pitching stuff to Will Smith with doing Bright. So I would like a little more of the background.
At that
knowledge.
Status, they're getting guaranteed money.
Yeah.
You know, that, you know.
Right,
if
but
you're,
are you making
if
as much if you release it in theaters versus releasing it on Netflix?
I think it's
residuals. That's
it's probably a safer play where you get your money up front. You're like, okay, we're buying your movie.
Right.
And then the distribution is Netflix. So you're guaranteed whatever. And Netflix has to, whether the movie is watched or not, they have to pay the same price.
Yeah.
So, all right. Now we're on to live Twitter questions. You can tweet us at Collider Video. Wendy, what do we got first?
The first one comes from Elijah M. Turner, who writes, do you think if massive budgeted films begin to fail regularly, will we see a renaissance in small budget filmmaking?
Yeah, I guess so.
Look at the best picture nominees. Silence. Most all of them are small budget type films. Moonlight, Lion. These are not very big films. I think there's always going to be counter programming to the bigger films.
I don't know that we need a renaissance of small filmmaking because there's so much opportunity for filmmakers to get some scratch together and put a movie out. What really has been squeezed out of film recently is the middle class, those middle production budgets where it's either a huge blockbuster movie or it's a tiny, tiny film. But luckily, those are also getting a lot of recognition. So I don't think you're ever going to see a day when studios aren't throwing tons of money behind their huge tentpole franchises. Now, maybe if some of those franchises start to fail, like if Transformers dips off, you won't see Transformers movies continue to be made, but there's always going to be something out there that people want to unite and get behind and go see. So you're always going to see big budget filmmaking, but I'm happy to see at least with tiny films, they have an opportunity to get their voice heard. And even more so now when we're talking about streaming services and on demand and stuff like that, there's more opportunity to get eyeballs on your movie, and I think that's a good thing.
It's just such a natural way how the industry works, too. I mean, look at the situation that Lionsgate is in now. Lionsgate is where it is because of the Hunger Games. Right. Then the Hunger Games ended, and now they're clamoring for their next big franchise. It's just the way you need to operate in order to keep a big studio afloat. So as long as we have these major studios out there with so much money to spend, I don't think big budget movies are going anywhere anytime soon.
Yeah, I think the what you're talking about, the mid-budget drama, has actually gone to television now. Mm-hmm. All those ideas for those, because it's been more successful in that arena. As far as, big budget movies, they're still going to make them. You know why? Because they need to get people into the theater. And so in order to do that, they need spectacle and large productions and something that benefits by seeing it on a very large screen with great sound. And as far as the indie stuff, it's like the indie stuff, already there was a revolution kind of in the 90s and then again in the early 2000s with digital. I mean, this is... Now you can make a movie for a lot cheaper than you could before. You didn't have to spend all that money on actual, film stock and film processing. And I think that the technology has made it a lot easier. But I don't see... Maybe distribution might help. We talked about Netflix before. Maybe there's a way to get smaller movies into that distribution method.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Chad writes, is the controversy / pushback to Beauty and the Beast going to hurt its opening weekend box office?
There's a controversy?
What controversy, Chad? What are you talking about?
I think he means the LeFou news.
Yeah.
Well, I suspect it's from the news yesterday.
From LeFou?
Yeah.
Just from that?
Being gay? No, I don't think it has. I don't think it's going to have a backlash at all. I can't imagine. You see people, morons online will go be like, oh, I'm not taking my kids to see this movie. You don't have kids. You're 11 years old and you live in your mom's basement. You're not creating any families, dipshit. So I don't think this is going to have any negative impact whatsoever. I think it's only going to have a positive impact because more people are going to be like, oh, good, Disney's being progressive. This is exciting. I want to go see this movie. Now $203 million. Okay.
Rocha?
Stop yelling at 11-year-olds. They're supposed to be in their mom's basement. They're 11 years old.
They're
morons. Gonna get their own apartment down the street at the play school? What's wrong with you? Look, here's the deal. The backlash is ridiculous to me with the LeFou stuff. I think it's great. It's beyond time. They have gay days at Disney, so it's beyond time that they brought it to the mainstream films that they do. However, there is the other backlash, which is the Stockholm Syndrome stuff. There is people that has numerous articles have been written about that, about how it's like he imprisons her, he forces her to like there's this call. So that's some of the backlash too. I'm not saying it's valid.
That's
I'm
what just, you should get I'm upset just, about. Not who LeFou is making out right, with, right. not on camera.
I agree.
You should be upset that there's an animal holding somebody hostage
right.
for months.
And keeping their dad as a, you know, in exchange for their dad and the livelihood, and then she falls in love with him. What does that mean? You know, so I think that's valid to explore that conversation. I'm not saying it's true, right? But I think it's valid. And that could be some of the backlash because that's been coming out. And I think Emma Watson has done a really great job in interviews pushing back against it. She is a great spokesperson for this kind of stuff because obviously she's been out there in the forefront as a feminist, as a person working for numerous causes across the world. So she's the right choice. That new article that came out, I think, in GQ or Vanity Fair, she pushes back against this idea of the Stockholm Syndrome stuff. So that stuff is there. I think the film, though, from what I'm hearing from other people who've gone to see it already, is going to overcome that stuff mm-hmm. and it'll make its money.
Backlash or no backlash, this is making a lot of money, yeah. not $200 million opening weekend.
Are you think more?
Is he okay, Rocha? $150. I know that will not pass for you, but $150 million opening weekend for Beauty and the Beast. He's making a nasty face. Actually, nasty he's face.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to affect the box office very much. If it does, maybe a little bit. People are going to go see this movie. Kids are going to go see this movie. They're going to see it multiple times.
You know what's really going to affect this movie? St. Patrick's Day. That's what's going to affect this movie. Here we go. So if you get too drunk and you stumble in the wrong theater,
sing-alongs. Sing-alongs.
Yeah. Natasha and Wendy, do you think this is actually a real controversy or is this something people are just kind of hyping up?
I think they're just hyping up. People like to scream and type whatever they want on the internet because there's no consequences to what they're writing.
Yeah. I mean, I don't really think that, like, I haven't heard that much controversy. I've heard the Stockholm Syndrome, right. but I don't know. I don't think anything can touch Beauty and the Beast,
it's
honestly. People are still going to see it. It's still going to make money. It's a classic franchise. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Untouchable.
Think about it in modern times, though. Because the Beast, yeah. Is he holding a prisoner? Yeah, and that's not cool. But he gives her a huge library to hang out in all day. So in modern times, that's like having a really kick-ass screening room, where if somebody's holding me hostage, but they said you can watch any movie ever in this cool screening room with all the free corn you can handle, I'm probably going to stay hostage for a while, though.
Dream big, Ellis.
Yeah. All right, what's next?
This one comes from Jonathan Peck, who writes, what Disney theme park rides or attraction would you like to see a movie adaptation of? The Matterhorn. Matterhorn.
I just went to Disneyland a couple days ago, and
they're gonna make one about chimichangas.
Really
chimichangas.
Yeah. You know what? Splash Mountain is so much fun to me. I think you could do something cool with Splash
but
Mountain.
But don't they have done a Splash Mountain Disney movie already?
They do, kind of loosely based.
Are you talking about the River Wild with Meryl Streep and Kevin Bacon?
No, it's like the Zippity Doodah, like wherever that movie comes from.
Song of the South.
Yeah,
it needs to be updated. It needs to be updated. Yeah,
I can see them revamping that one.
Problem people might have with a movie. Song of the South should be updated.
No, it should be.
Let's not touch that.
It should be. It needs to be changed a little bit.
It should be buried and never seen again.
Maybe that too, but Thunder Mountain's a pretty sweet ride.
There we go.
I haven't been to Disneyland in a while. I can't even remember all. I know that after they put Star Wars Land in there, I'm going to be going mm-hmm. a ton. I think, isn't like the Pandora, the Avatar, that's coming out this year at Disneyland as
yeah.
well. So
I think so, yeah.
I'm looking forward to those two. I'm trying to think care. Of what rides they have.
Isn't Maelstrom a ride? Is the Maelstrom thing a ride? The Maelstrom thing a ride with Vikings and all that? Is that?
I know
that sounds like a Six Flags. No,
I mean, they did
I would want an Everest.
I got
movie.
One.
Have
Jungle
you guys ever
Cruise.
Been on Everest?
Oh my God!
Doing
yes,
it.
Be so.
Oh, yeah. But they're already doing it. The
that
Rock's
awesome.
Doing it.
Yeah.
The Rock's doing it, Natasha.
I haven't heard
Jungle
anything
Cruise.
About that.
Really?
For real?
Yes.
Oh. I just hope it doesn't end up whatever next movie they make on a ride. I know it wasn't a ride, but Tomorrowland. That,
oh gosh, yeah.
It was a disappointing
film. That was so bad.
That was so close to being good.
I was looking forward to it.
Yeah. They should do an Everest one. You know, with the Yeti?
Everest is a ride at Disneyland?
It's at Disney World.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
If you put Disney World
in this conversation, it gives you a lot more rides to choose from.
What about Dino Land? Is that possible?
Why not?
You're just making up rides now.
I'm not making up rides.
You're literally just inventing things.
This is on their website. I'm looking at their Fantasmic. Here's another one.
Fantasmic.
See, there we go.
That would be so fun.
How about Shockwave? That's a King's Dominion.
That's a King. Oh, okay. No, we're not making Virginia
living
references.
Guys,
I could talk about Disneyland all day, okay?
Yeah. All right, what's next?
Wade Aiken writes, any movies you don't see due to subject matter, or as pundits feel that you have to see movies regardless of personal preference?
Well, everyone knows my answer to this question. If I didn't have to go see a dog's purpose, I most certainly wouldn't have.
Sorry, Perri.
Yeah. It's okay, Wendy. I forgive you.
I sent her to that one.
Yeah.
I wasn't crazy about checking out the Nymphomaniac. It's not my kind of thing. I'm not a. There's other people on this panel that can probably speak to adult films much better than I can.
I wonder.
Don't look at me. Don't point the camera at me.
I didn't say who. I'm just look. The camera goes where the camera wants to go. I don't control.
Yeah, I have
this
that problem sometimes myself. Listen, I don't. I'm not a fan of those films either. And also, anything with like rape stuff, I have a really really hard time watching films like The Accused and Monster. Those were really, really hard films to get through, and I've only ever seen them once. And it's like, I would love to never see a film like that, you know?
For me, I mean, everyone knows I don't really watch too much horror, but I mean, there's some stuff that I will watch, but the stuff I won't watch is the torture porn horror that is just purely like, okay, this is just gore.
I have my limits with that too. Like Human Centipede, I actually think first Human Centipede movie is kind of an interesting, well-told story, and it's well executed too. The other two, though, are the most atrocious things I've ever seen. It's disgusting. It's Tom Six being like, oh, look at this phenomenon I created with the first one. Let me just see how many times I can beat you over the head with it and make you want to just shut it off or vomit or I don't know. I hate those movies.
Look, if you can't see the artistry of sewing butts to mouths, I don't know that you should be in the movie critic world. I mean, it's, you know?
It's genius.
Yeah. We're sewing a centipede together, but it's a human.
It's
it's
a gimmick in the second two. In the first one, it really is like a disturbing mad scientist where it has this really eerie buildup. It's not just doing it for the sake of doing it. I give the first one credit. The second two, no.
They need to remake the classic Man with Two Heads with Ray Milland and Rosie Grier. That's the one they remake. If you're going to sew body parts to body parts, that's the one.
Dennis, I think the big takeaway from this episode of Movie Talk is that if you're out on a date with somebody, you need to establish at the first date, before you even get the main course, you should say, hey, where do you draw the line with Human Centipede? Is it one? Is it three? Where are you not okay with it?
That's how you know how far the relationship will go.
That's right, yeah.
Or where the relationship will go. That's for sure.
No.
All right, let's not end on that note. Let's do one more.
It's Friday, though, man.
Rocha is off the schedule for the next movie talk. All right, this question comes from Rob Galifassi, who writes, I know these were totally different films, but did you guys enjoy Logan more or Deadpool more?
For me, it's Logan. I like Deadpool a lot. I still had Civil War last year above Deadpool. Some people didn't. Those were kind of the two comic book movies that people had battling for their top spot. Logan, for me, is one of the best comic book movies of all time. I think it transcends the genre. And I think it'd be hard to see any other comic movie topping that this year.
I agree. I think Logan, absolutely. I think Deadpool's fantastic for what it was. The love story is so great. That's what grounds that film. It makes it so unique in the superhero genre. And it's so good. And Ryan Reynolds is so fantastic. But Logan is another world, man. And because of the disappointment we felt with those separate Wolverine movies, I think overall, having something come out that is so incredibly better than anything that has come before it in that particular character's portrayal makes Logan stand out so much more. And for those of us who have been hardcore fans of him in every version that he's come in for decades, to see something so fully realized that is Wolverine on screen, hashtag old man Logan, it is so moving and powerful, and you're just happy when you leave the theater that they got it right.
Perri?
Yeah, I'm definitely going with Logan on this one. It is one of my favorite comic book movies now of all time. It's great. I will say, though, when people were starting to talk about Deadpool getting an Academy Award nomination, I went back because I had only seen it once at that time, and I went back just to see. That's a very well-written screenplay. Deadpool is really damn good. It's just Logan to me. It really just blew my mind how much I wound up loving that movie.
I'm still digesting Logan. I think I could safely say it's my favorite of the three movies I saw yesterday, which is pretty high praise. Well. Deadpool, though, did something that I didn't think a movie could do to that level where it could be. Like, we've seen good sense of humor in films before. Like, there's a lot of great comedy in Iron Man or The Avengers. I didn't know a comic book movie could be that funny and also have a lot of great action and a story that grounds it. So I think we're going to give the edge to Deadpool. It's clearly the more rewatchable of the two, but I think Deadpool might be my favorite over Logan, but it's a really close call.
Wendy, Natasha, did you guys see both of them, and what do you think?
It's kind of like what Ellis was saying. Like, Deadpool was so much fun, really pushed the boundary of comic book movies. I don't really see Logan as a comic book movie. So I'm going to say I enjoyed Deadpool more, not to take away from Logan. I thought Logan was phenomenal, but I really did enjoy Deadpool a lot.
Natasha, yeah, I mean, I haven't seen Logan, but just based off of everything, I'm super excited for it. Guys, I haven't seen Deadpool either because it's just not my kind of movie.
Oh, we should have put her in the commentary.
So
it's a love story.
I can see Natasha covering her ears when she's watching Deadpool.
it's a
just
love story.
Not my kind of story. I guess I heard
it's
that
it because
was
a love story.
Natasha's too
is.
She's watching those centipede movies, and I told you to turn those off, and you go see a comic book.
Yeah, but I mean, just in terms of piquing my interest from Deadpool to Logan, I'm definitely seeing Logan just because I've just been so into every trailer that I've seen. So I think just that being said, I would go more for Logan than Deadpool because that didn't pique my interest, even with all the hype. I know, don't murder me on the chat room, but have to.
All right, guys, that's it for today's episode of Collider Movie Talk. Thanks for joining us. I also like to thank the people joining us on the panel. Perri, where can people find you?
You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at PNMROF. And tomorrow, Collider Behind the Scenes, 2 p.m. PST. Check it out.
Rocha.
Hey, you guys can always find me at The Rocha Says on Twitter and on Instagram. Every Sunday night, Walking Dead review show with three of the panelists here, minus Ellis, right? I think that's right. You never come on.
Yeah.
You never
Well, no,
come
I
on,
watched right? The Walking Dead with you guys, then I review it too on a separate.
On a street corner. and this Saturday, tomorrow, drops my Movie Fights trilogy against Scott Mance on the Screen Junkies YouTube channel. So go and watch that as well.
Ellis?
You can find my Walking Dead review on a little channel called Schmoes Know. And you can follow me on Twitter at Mark Ellis Live. Hey, later on today, the movie Trivia Schmodown between Clark Wolf. She's classy and JT. He's not, but he's certainly evil and he's little. It's going to be an epic matchup. Make sure you guys check it out.
Wendy?
You can find me on YouTube at The Movie Couple Channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat at Wendy Lee Zaney.
Natasha?
And you guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at NatashaLexis_.
And you guys can find me on Twitter at ThinkHero, Instagram, Dennis.TZNG. You can find me on Movie Talks on Fridays, also on The Walking Dead Review Show with Perri, Rocha, and Josh McCuga. Also, like I mentioned before, check out Awesome Tackler. This week's episode, I directed the La La Land sketch video. So thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys next time.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.